reigning King and the Lord of Lords, mercifully grant that the peoples of the earth, divided and enslaved by sin, may be freed and brought together under his most gracious rule, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated.
God put his hard work in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in heavenly places, far above all who rule in authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but in the age to come. And he has put all things under his feet and has made him the head over all things in the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, 'Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me.' Then the righteous will answer him, 'Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?' And the king will answer them, 'Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me.' Then he will say to those at his left hand, 'You that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me.' Then they also will answer, 'Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not take care of you?' Then he will answer them, 'Truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me.' And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Any of that, and it bothered me because I saw someone digging in the garbage can and eating food. So without thinking, I went back into Hardee's and bought another one of those meals they have. And I walked outside and I walked up to the man and I said, "This is for you." And he said, "Thank you." And even when I walked away, I couldn't ignore the initial vision of what I saw, whereas so many people did. They saw the man and just walked past him. Now, what caught my attention the most was that he was by himself. He wasn't asking for anything. He wasn't accosting anybody. He was by himself, minding his business. I took it upon myself to go about his business. But I felt like that was something that I was called to do. After this, I realized to begin what a comfortable life I had growing up. I never knew what it was like to be hungry. I never knew what it was like to have to wonder about where my next meal was coming from. And it would have been very easy for me to have pretended like I didn't see that man and just walk by him, which so many people did. But something in me knew better. And of course, as many of you will know, I'm going to say it was because of the way I was reared. I did it because I knew that I did what I did, but I knew what was better. That I knew that a solid moral and Christian foundation had been laid for me at an early age. I was taught to help and to help those who are less fortunate, to have compassion, and to show what and to share what you have with others. In Luke 12:48, Jesus tells us that from everyone to whom much has been given, much will be required. And from the one to whom much has been entrusted, even more will be demanded. On this, the last Sunday after Pentecost, we find ourselves at the point in the Gospel leading up to the Passion of Jesus. Throughout the Gospel of Matthew, and up to this point, Jesus has been calling us to discipleship and teaching us new parables about the kingdom of heaven and how to secure our place in it. Before his Passion, Jesus offers up one last parable for those who still may not be clear about who will get to see heaven. He chooses two seemingly unrelated animals to use as metaphors for the righteous and the unrighteous: sheep and goats. Sheep are often seen as nice, peaceful animals that follow the shepherd wherever he goes. Goats are often seen as boisterous, noisy animals that often have a mind of their own. I can attest to this because in high school, one of my classmates had a pet goat. And every time I would go to his house, we'd hear this banging noise because they had a wooden fence to cut off the driveway from the backyard, and the goat was just constantly. But I couldn't understand why someone would want that as a pet. But needless to say, I was told that they do have a purpose. In ancient Middle Eastern culture, during the time of Jesus, sheep and goats were raised together and were equally valued. They were often separated at night due to the inability of goats to endure the cold, and the sheep were allowed to be free. Also, in this ancient culture, the lowest right represented good and honorable place, and the left represented the bad and dishonorable. If we apply this knowledge to the parable, the sheep are associated with the follower of Jesus. Sheep represent eternal life, whereas goats represent punishment. The obedient sheep, those who follow the shepherd, will find themselves on the right hand of God, and the boisterous goats will find themselves on their own. And they will find themselves also on the left. The placement of right or left is based upon the deeds, and not the works of those done by those who will be judged when the Son of Man returns. In this parable, Jesus is telling us something that he has said many, many times in various parables and in his greatest commandment. Jesus' greatest commandment is called his love commandment, that we should love our neighbors as ourselves. It's the undercurrent of the judging by the Son of Man. There is an old saying, you cannot buy your way into heaven. Doing what is right and following Jesus' commandment at all times is what gets you on the right hand of God. We cannot work ourselves into eternal life. It must be genuine and a part of our daily lives. Our judgment will be based on how we responded to Jesus' call to action for us in regard to how we treat our neighbor. In life, we have become somewhat skeptical, not only about the return of the Son of Man, but also about our neighbors and their true intentions. We see so many people on the streets asking for money that we judge them all as not being truly in need. I know I have done that myself. We look away when we see a homeless person coming toward us, or look and say, how sad, and keep moving. If a person came up to you and asked for a drink because they were thirsty, what would you do? When did you last welcome a stranger, clothed and naked, take care of the sick, or visited someone who was incarcerated? Our judging of others can often keep us from being the true follower of Christ that he wants us to be. Yes, it is natural to self-protect, but it is not Christ-like to paint everyone in need that we meet with the same brush. To assume that everyone who asks us for help is not being truthful. Some of the people that we encounter, the least of these, are truly down on their luck and in need of our compassion and help. But how do we know which are sincere? The answer is that we really do not know. While we cannot in all reality help everyone, we can, could, and should help someone. God is everywhere, and we may miss opportunities to encounter God if we look away from those who are in need, if we look away from those who need our help. And I can think of one encounter about 3 years ago when I first became a priest at my first church. There was a convenience store right down the street that I had to pass each day on my way to church. And as many of you know, I have an addiction to Coca-Cola. So I would stop at this little store because you could get two for $1. And also do a little chocolate, but in case it's a little snack for one. Anyway, when I pulled up to the store, I said, oh Lord, there they are, they're going to hit me up or something. So I went into my car, and just so happened my senior warden pulled up, so I got with him and I was hired, because I knew what was going to happen. But as I left the store with my two coats and my little baby snack cake, a man came up to me and asked if I had something to drink, if I could give him money for something to drink. And my first reaction was to say no, but then I stopped and said, wait a minute, I have these two coats in my bag. I can give him one, and they go back into the store and buy another. And he said, thank you very much, I was so thirsty. And again, there's another one of those passing moments that has sort of stuck with me. I could easily have said, no, they won't go away from me, these are my coats for later. And I realized that I was able to buy more coats if I needed them, so I needed to share what I had with somebody else. I did this not to curry favor with God, but because maybe for a split second, I looked at him instead of looking away and saw something or someone in him, maybe Christ. The Son of Man will return again, but since we do not know when, we must always act in a righteous manner for our neighbor. Although the urgency of the return of the Son of Man does not seem so great to us as it once was to our ancestors and those of the ancient world, we should still follow the commandment of Jesus, which is to love our neighbor as ourselves. Do what is right, not because you think that it will benefit you or even earn you a spot in heaven, but do it instinctively and with genuineness. Jesus wants to help us, the least of these, by dying upon the cross for our salvation. He did not judge who was worthy and who was not. He simply did it because we were a people in need of forgiveness. His body was broken and his blood was shed so that we might have salvation and one day be able to sit at the right hand of God. With this in mind, as we come to the Lord's table, let us in remembrance of him, care for the sick, feed the poor, open our hearts to those in need, search for truth, and love our neighbor. As the season of Pentecost comes to a close, we will begin awaiting the arrival of the Messiah with the season of Advent. As Jesus' journey comes to an end in today's gospel, on next week we will wait for with great anticipation as his life is about to begin. The parents of Jesus will find themselves in need as they prepare for the birth of their child. Jesus, who was born lowly, will be in need of food, clothing, and shelter. This child, born of a virgin and a carpenter, this child, the Son of God, will become a king and show us all what it means to love our neighbor as ourselves. This king will feed the hungry, clothe the naked, heal the sick, and care for all, including the stranger, without reservation or judgment. This king will teach us not to look away, but to look to him. So when we look to him, we also look to God. As we celebrate Christ the King Sunday and look forward with anticipation and joy to the beginning of the Advent season, let us keep in mind that when Jesus returns to earth, he will be the only judge that matters. If we keep this in mind throughout our lives, that our hearts should be open to helping our brothers and sisters who come to us in times of need. Let us always help the least of these, for among them might be the Son of Man, looking to see if you will look at him or look away. All standing, I return to page 358 of our Book of Common Prayer in the front of the page. We believe in one God,
the Father of the Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth,
of all that is seen and unseen.
We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally God from our Father, God from God, light from light, true God, true God, begotten and created, of one being the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sakes, he was crucified on the cross of Pilate. He suffered death in the grave and buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in your glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will not have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, and your Lord God, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped for our God. He has spoken to the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic Church, the Catholic Church. We acknowledge one baptism of guilt and forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Prayers of the people may be found on page 387 of the Book of Common Prayer. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church.
That we all may be one.
Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you.
That your name may be glorified by all people.
We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons.
That they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments.
We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on the earth.
Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works and our faith may be raised in life.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
That they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest.
That the light perpetual shine upon them.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May they also come to share in your heavenly
kingdom. Let us pray for our own needs and those of others, especially Charles, Eddie, Francis, Juanita, Dorothy, Levi, Harmon, Mildred, Cherish, Charles, Geneva, Gloria, Martha. We pray for the Fresh Start clients and for the volunteers that help with this vital ministry. We pray for our country during this time of transition. Are there others?
Lord, hear the prayers of our people and what we have asked faithfully. Grant that we may obtain effectually for the glory by name through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God,
we confess our sins against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not held you in our hope or our heart. We have not held our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and humbly hope. For the sake of this moment, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, that we may live our lives in the world.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Please stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
I'm sure our spiritual committee will be happy to know that you didn't get some in the box this morning. Some carbs. This prayer actually is a very nice prayer over the pledge cards. This prayer was written by the Rite Reverend
Rickel, who is a diocesan bishop in the Diocese of Olympia, Washington. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, giver of all that is good and true and beautiful and life-giving, these cards represent our sweat, they represent our lives, they represent our dreams. The pledges which are made on them are the tokens of the awesome gifts that have been given to us, and they are pledged in thanksgiving for all we have received, for all we have been inspired to be, for all we are challenged to become in this place. May they be the first fruits of all we have and not what we have left over, so that we may live out as closely as possible how you give to us. May we see them as an offering to you, sacred, holy, yet earthly, filled with possibilities. May we hold this image in our hearts and minds so as we watch our offerings each week come to your table, we can see our very selves being part of this offering. It is us on the table, living sacrifices to you. Amen.
Amen.
One more announcement which I must make, because in every church I have been in, this has been quite a farce. In the bulletin, our prayer today will be prayer C, which means it requires your participation. Everyone needs to turn to page 369 when we get there, so that there are no awkward pauses until we are being filmed. Okay. Offer to God a sacrifice of thanksgiving and make good your vows to the Most High.
Thank you. 359 of the Book of Common Prayer.
The Lord be with you.
Pardon only and not for renewal. Let the grace of this Holy Communion
make us one body, one spirit in Christ, that we may worthily serve the world in his name.
Risen Lord, be known to us in the breaking of bread.
Accept these prayers and praises, Father, through Jesus Christ, our great high priest, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit.